I invite you to join me in mind, in heart, and in spirit for today's reading. Today's reading comes from the Journal for Joyous Living by Petra Wells and Christian Sorensen. Do not be afraid of the negativity in the world or in someone else. Each time you are confronted with negativity, whether it's in the news or on TV or from the mouth of a friend, it is a call to prayer. Rather than becoming worried, fearful, or angry, move into the centered space within that you know and feel every time you go into meditation or prayer. Pray for peace, healing, justice, and right action. Speak your word of truth that spirit is present and everything will turn out for good. You will be a benevolent presence to everyone, including yourself and to life itself. If you will, please go into the silence for a moment with me and take these words with you. And I give thanks for this amazing brand new day, for this infinite moment of love, for this wondrous day filled with unprecedented opportunities for more love, more peace, more growth, more healing, more happiness. I give thanks for this incredible service. I give thanks for every moment of our time together. I give thanks knowing that this service is a blessed event. I'm knowing each and every one of us is so deeply loved, supported, and blessed throughout this time, throughout all of our lives, throughout this day. And I know that this is so. And I'm knowing for Reverend Cece that the divine within her, of who she truly is, of who she is always, comes forth and speaks forth, and that we hear with the divine within us, and that we are uplifted and inspired. And I'm knowing that our children in the back are also being uplifted and inspired in this moment. I'm knowing that everybody who is here, everybody who participates in this service, is divinely blessed, uplifted, and inspired. And I'm knowing that the music ministry definitely is inspired. That everyone here is here for love. And love is what is spoken here. Love, it is is what is experienced here. And I give thanks. I give thanks for the perfection of it all. So be it, and so it is. Amen.
So last year, our whole organization, gave up a long-standing tradition of our summer conference at the Isla Mar State Park in California. It's right just barely south of Monterey. And we gave it up because conditions changed, and the private company that took over its management wanted us to give them $1 million deposit, and we just didn't have one. You know, we didn't have $1 million laying around, so we gave it up. But what I want to share with you today comes out of that many, many, many years tradition of meeting there at Isla Mar, and of Ernest Holmes, our founder, every year giving the closing talk for that summer conference. And it was called the Sermon by the Sea because he gave it in the chapel, and they opened up the curtains, and through the back window behind him you could see the Pacific Ocean. It's a gorgeous setting, and so it was always called the Sermon by the Sea. And in 1959, he gave his last Sermon by the Sea because he died in 1960. And there are some points in it that are really moving to me, and I think really important to remember in this spiritual path that we walk together. And he starts out with one of my very favorite Ernest Holmes sayings ever. He said, "Find me one person who is for something and against nothing, who is redeemed enough not to condemn others out of the burden of his own soul, and I will find another Savior, another Jesus, an exalted human being." Find me someone who is for something and against nothing. I love that. It's something that I hold up as a light for my path, to be something, to be for something and against nothing. And I also know it's one of the most difficult things ever. It's really difficult. We, as human beings, are trained in this world to be yes and no, for and against, black and white, good and bad, aren't we? And we sort of lean in that direction all the time. And we know what the right thing is, and so we're against the wrong thing. To be for something and against nothing is a different kind of a stance. It's a stance that comes from remembering what we're really for. What do I really stand for in life, in this world? What are my strongest values? What is most important to me? If I'm for oneness, if I'm for recognizing that divine within everybody around me, then I can't be against any of them, right? I can't be against any of it. And it's this difficult position to take, to always be for something and against nothing. On the other hand, try talking to someone who is for something that you're not for, from that position of being against it. Two againsts come together and nothing good happens, right? You just wind up with heartburn and more anger and more frustration, and it never works. It just never works. We have to come to our differences, and our differences between ourselves and our differences with the world from a bigger place, I think. From a place of standing on what we're for. From a place of looking. You know, the interesting thing for me is that whenever I'm for something and somebody else is for something different, somewhere we have a value in common. Somewhere we both find the same thing important in the world. We just may see it differently, but if I can come from where what I'm standing for, that important value, I might be able to actually have a conversation with the person, and we might be on the way towards resolving or coming up with yet a third larger way that will allow us both to be for what we're for and against, not against each other. The second thing he said in this talk, Ernest Holmes, he said, find me one person who no longer has any fear of the universe or of God or of anything else, and you will have brought to me someone in whose presence we may sit, and fear shall vanish as clouds with the sunlight. Find me someone who no longer has any fear of the universe. Whew, it's another really hard thing to do. It's another really difficult stance to take, and it makes being for something and against nothing even harder, because we're against what we're afraid is going to happen to us, aren't we? We're afraid that that's going to be what happens, and we're going to have to live with it even though we don't like it, and we're afraid it's going to be what we'll get. But here's the thing: whatever we're afraid of, we're giving our energy to, we're making it more likely that it's going to happen. We're going to, you know, call it forth in our experience, the more energy we give to it. And so if we can somehow figure out how not to be afraid of life, we're much more likely to be able to be for something and against nothing. The third thing that he said in this talk that I love is, find me someone who has given all she has in love without morbidity, and I will have found the lover of my soul. She will have revealed to me the nature of God and proved to me the possibility of all human souls. What does that mean? What does it mean to give all that we are in love without morbidity? I think he's talking about doing it without fear. You know the fear I'm talking about. If I love this person, are they going to love me back? If I love this person, will they reject me? If I give everything I have in love, will I get enough back to survive? We have this fear deep at our core that we don't often talk about. And it keeps us from pouring ourselves out in love, because we might lose ourselves. We might lose our good stuff. We might lose our lovingness in pouring ourselves out in love. It's telling us once again that our egos are pretty self-obsessed, aren't they? They're pretty obsessed about what we're going to get and how we're going to do and whether we're going to get back as good as we get and all that other stuff. And it brings us right back to being against something and afraid of something instead of for something and pouring ourselves out in love. He said, find me one person who can get his own littleness out of the way, and he shall reveal to me the immeasurable magnitude of the universe in which I live. I love that. Find me one person who can get his own littleness out of the way, and he will reveal to me the magnitude of this universe. He went on, find me one person who has so completely divorced herself from all arrogance, and you will have discovered for me an open pathway to the kingdom of God, here and now. Whew. These are not easy things to think about, are they? Littleness and arrogance, hand in hand. Hand in hand from that part of us that doesn't know how not to be against anything. From that part of us that doesn't know how to live without fear. It wants to keep us small, and yet it does that by bringing up our arrogance. We stay small by saying to someone else, well, you're smaller than me, right? It's that weird, weird thing the ego does to us by, it keeps us small by trying to make us better than other people. Or so worse, so much worse than other people. That's arrogant as well. Either end of that is the place of arrogance. It's the place of being separate from. Which is why all this stuff happens in the first place. It's why all this stuff happens in the first place. Because we have this sense that we're separate from one another and from God and from life and from the planet and from everything else. It's a false sense, but it seems really real. It seems really real. Finally, Ernest Holmes said, find me someone who has detached his emotional and psychological ego from the real self, without having to deny its place in the scheme of things. The ego has a place. It does. Find me somebody who has detached his emotional and psychological ego from his real self without having to deny the place it plays in the scheme of things, and without slaying any part of himself, because the transcendence is there too. I love that. We don't have to kill any part of ourselves. It's all God. I'm all God. You're all God. We are all God. The transcendence is always there. We don't have to kill it. We simply have to realize that the emotional and psychological ego has a function. And if we keep it to that function and not let it take over the rest of us, then we can be for something and against nothing. And we can pour ourselves out in love and only grow, never suffer. The emotional and the psychological, Mark and I were talking about this morning, my husband and I, as I was eating breakfast. You know, the Dalai Lama has an ego that allows him to say, I feel compassion towards you. And that's its only function, is for me to say, I feel this towards you, what do you feel? Or here's what I think, what do you think? Or here's what I value, tell me what you value. That's its only function, is to let us get by in the world of human life. Other than that, it's a pretty lame companion. Other than that, it's the thing that says, I'll feel better if I make this person seem not as smart, not as strong, not as brave, not as good looking as I am. Or I'll feel loved if I can coerce this person into doing it my way. Or all those other crazy things the ego comes up with. The ego is a function of the brain, I think. And the brain is the most interesting part of this skin suit that we've been given to live in. Because it's evolutionarily a big stack of old parts, right? The first part of it says, everything's dangerous, look out. That's the oldest part. The next oldest part says, ooh, that's good, I want it. It goes towards the goodies. And then we have this evolved part, the human cortex, neocortex, which says, that is me. It attaches to everything, everything. And how I act is me, and what people say about me is me, and you know, all these feelings I have, that's who I am. My job is who I am. My clothes are who I am. My husband is who I am. It attaches to everything. And the ego works through the mind. No wonder it's kind of having a hard time. It's either running for its life, getting all it can and canning all it gets, or attaching. The real us works through another part of us, the mind, the consciousness, the thing that can see the ego and the brain and say, this is what I got to work with. How can I best use this equipment, if you will? How can I best use this? And that's our task in life, I think, is to remember who we really are. We're not the brain. We're not the ego. We're not the suit we wear. We're not the things we've done. We are life itself. We are the divine life making its way into the world by means of us. And when we can remember that, we can be for what we're for. And there is no need to be against anything. There's no need to judge anything. There's no need to turn our back on anything or say, that's not like me, because it's all like me, and I'm like all of it. It's an amazing, amazing transition, and it starts by simply realizing that we do that stuff with our egos. We do it. Everybody does. Our brain is always functioning, and there's always a part of us that's saying, what's dangerous here? And there's always a part of us saying, what can I eat here? And there's always a part of us saying, how is this me? And then there's a part of us that says, you are so much more than all of that, than any of it. There's a part of us that takes this giant view of things and says, I see myself in every face. I see God everywhere I look. That's what I really am. That's what I really am. But all that stuff is still all going on. And if we simply acknowledge it, that's the first step towards owning it rather than having it own you, right? I think the way that Ernest Holmes is telling us to step into that place of being love and of walking that open pathway is to remind ourselves of what our values are, first off. What's your highest value? If your highest value is love, you can't be hating somebody because they have a different opinion than you. Guilty as charged. If your highest value is integrity, for me, I can't be doing things at home that I wouldn't do here. I can't be treating my husband in a way I wouldn't treat anybody else. Guilty as charged. Oh, more secrets. Oh, I'm still remembering last week's talk about secrets. Here they are. Sometimes I treat my husband in ways that I think, who walked in here and did that? You know, I know better. I feel better. I don't want to do that. And yet, there's a part of me that's saying, what's dangerous here? What can I eat here? And that's me, right? And sometimes when I'm tired, when I'm not prayed up enough, when I haven't been meditating as much as I need to, it gets the better of me. I forget that it's in operation, it gets the better of me. If we can just remember, first off, what our values are and ask ourselves, how does my conduct line up with that? You know, am I acting in accordance with my values, my positive values of love and integrity and peace? If I'm peaceful, I can't be stirring stuff up with someone who doesn't agree with me. I need to bring peace wherever I go. Second, I love this one. If we make it a priority to feel good, we'll be a lot further down this road, because feeling, the way we feel springs directly from what we think about. So if we're thinking about God supporting us, we feel good. If we're thinking about, oh my God, what's to be scared of here, we don't feel good. If we think about pouring ourselves out in love because we know there's an unlimited supply of love pouring into us, we feel good. But if we're over here thinking about, are they going to love me back? We don't feel good. You know what I mean? You make it a priority to feel good. You start to do things that support that. We start to remember that love is the currency of the universe, and it's always there. And when we give it, we're immediately refilled with it, even more than we had before. If we remember that our real self is our real self, and this other stuff is equipment that the real self uses, we feel good. We feel good. We just enter into that peaceful place within us rather than worrying about what's dangerous, what can I eat, and how can I attach to this. Which leads us to this commitment, I think, to enlarge our hearts bit by tiny bit, moment by tiny moment, hour by hour and day by day. We enlarge our hearts because the heart is the thing that sees the truth. The heart is the thing that knows that we're supported. The heart is the place that recognizes our true self. And we enlarge the heart a little tiny bit by remembering that it's absolutely okay to hold two things that seem contradictory at the same time. It's okay to hold my opinion and your opinion, which may seem contradictory, within my heart at the same time, to just hold them there and let them be. I don't have to act on them. I don't have to tell you that you don't know what you're talking about. I don't have to cave in to you. All I have to do is hold them there. And if we are incredibly blessed, the holding becomes paradox. Because paradox is truth, isn't it? Paradox is two seemingly contradictory things, both of which are absolutely true. It's truth. It's life. It's the way things are. There is a condition, as Ernest Holmes says, we never ignore the condition, and there is God. There is this broken bone, and underneath it and behind it is the physical perfection of God. There is racism in the world, and sexism, and ageism, and homophobia, and there is love. There is oneness, there is unity, there is God. And all of those things are true at the same time. And when we can hold those paradoxes as true, sometimes it's little t true and big t true, but when we can hold them, they may begin to resolve themselves, because we don't walk forward stuck in the little t truth. We walk forward in the truth with a capital T of love. We walk forward in the truth with a capital T of oneness. We walk forward in the capital T truth that everyone in front of us is God in manifestation. So when we can do that, when we can let our hearts enlarge a little bit, that's what our reading is talking about today, I think. When we start to feel, you know, like we need to hyperventilate and panic and get all we can and can all we get because of the news, I don't know about you, but it makes me just think, oh my God, I don't know what to do. Then we have to remember what to be. We have to remember to move into that centered place that we find in meditation or prayer and know the capital T truth of justice and truth and peace and love and joy and harmony and oneness. And then when we move, when we do so from that place, which is like taking our candle and lighting another candle and another candle and another candle and another candle, and pretty soon the whole world's lit up and we're just as bright as we were when we started. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. And so I think Holmes is giving us some great instructions here. Find me one person who is for something and against nothing. One person who no longer fears God or life or the universe or any other person. Find me someone who has given all in love. Someone who can get her own littleness out of the way. Someone who has divorced himself from all arrogance. Someone who has detached his ego from the real self. And you will have found another Savior, another Jesus, a pathway to God, the place of communion, the place of unity, the place that lifts us up so high that all of those seeming contradictions and paradoxes are resolved. And that's the place we're intended to live. Every single one of us, we're all intended to live from that place. And so the invitation is to remind yourself, what are the values that you hold most dear and how do you live from them? And what is the ego trying to do for you? And what's it trying to do to you? What is love trying to show you as it makes its way from you into the world? Because when we simply dwell on those kinds of questions, we're lifted into that higher view where we can be for life and against nothing. We can be for each other and against no one, and we can be for love. Always. So we invite you simply to let your awareness go into that place of light and joy that you find in prayer and meditation. That place of peace and calm and gratitude. Because it is in that place that we find the true self, the divine spark, the God presence within each one of us. The same presence and power that spoke into being all creation and that spread itself throughout that creation. So that truly, everywhere we look, we can see the face of God if our eyes are clear. If we simply remember who we are that divine self. We are that great universal heart of love. We are the light that can light up thousands of lives without losing one bit of its brilliance. That is the truth of our being. That is the truth of everyone here. And so I know that each one of us confidently moves into that place of standing for all that is good and true and real and beautiful and against nothing, defenseless. Because there is no need to defend, and there's nothing to defend. Strong, because love pours from us into the world, strong beyond strength, because we are love. And I know that each one of us does this as a beneficial presence to the world, but also as a beneficial presence to our own lives. Because the way we do it is by caring for ourselves, by allowing ourselves to grow, by removing our own arrogance from our pathway so that others see and act and are drawn near to us. Because I know this is the truth of every single person here, I give thanks. I give thanks that we have had this time together this morning to remember and to celebrate and to give thanks for life itself, for this amazing path that we walk, for this confusing, wonderful paradox called spiritual beings having a human experience. I give thanks for all of it and for this community of love and joy, this community of peace, of justice. And from this place of thanksgiving, I simply let it all go, let it all be, knowing that it's already so. And we say together, and so it is.
I am remembering who I am. I am remembering.
Have a moment now to be grateful, to just fall into gratitude as we prepare to give in support of this spiritual community. Because it is from gratitude that our abundance flows. It is gratitude that says yes to more good in our lives. So take a moment to just count your blessings and just realize how loved you are and how love loves you. And I ask you to simply bless our community and its abundance in this moment of gratitude. And please repeat after me. Gratefully I give with an attitude of abundance. I know that as I give, so do I receive. And so it is.